ordinary run-of-the-mill shawarma. It's a huge, delicious shawarma named Best Shawarma in Detroit 5 years in a row. Heading downtown, maybe to a ball game, then grab a beef, chicken, vegetarian, or Bucharest shawarma. They're more than enough to fill you up. You'll also love their freshly made burgers, hummus, soups, and salads. At all three Bucharest locations, Jefferson near Shane, on Paquette in the New Center area, and the newly remodeled Michigan Avenue Crooktown Bucharest Grill. Bucharest Grill's Jefferson location features an amazing coffee and tea bar, along with freshly prepared cheesecakes in a variety of flavors, plus tiramisu and lemon cake. Downtown delivery, dine-in service, and free parking at all three Bucharest Grills. You just can't top Bucharest Grill. Open weekdays 10 to 11, weekends 11 to 11. Call 313-965-3111 or log on to BucharestGrill.com. Hi, Dan Petrie, here with my wife, Chris, to tell you about Northville Lumber's new No-Buy Home Design Center.
Our house needed some updating, especially new windows and doors. But when it comes to home improvements, Dan can be a little...
Yeah, I admit it, I'm cheap.
Well, the door and window team at Northville Lumber listened and came back with a proposal that worked for both of us.
Northville Lumber was great, and so were the results.
So, if you need new windows or doors, James Hardy Siding, or a referral to a great contractor, we recommend Northville Lumber's No-Buy Home Design Center at 9 Mile and No-Buy Road, or visit NoBuyHomeDesignCenter.com.
Batting practice.
Look, I
If the Tigers are waving, I wonder if anybody would come back.
No. I mean, he might, like, emergency starter. Can't call up a guy from AAA who wants to sign Sanchez for a start. I don't know. Like, I can't imagine. He gives up home runs every single appearance. It's bizarre.
Yeah, it didn't look last night.
Or the time before.
And bouncing that ground ball, the throw from Hicks to him over covering first base. That hurt. That hurt a lot. Just watching it was painful. But yeah, he pitched 4 innings. He struck out 5 and didn't walk anybody. But he gave up 6 hits and 4 runs. 3 of them earned because he didn't hang on to the baseball.
He's so bad. He is. Let
me say this, okay? Because I'm agreeing with you. And remember, I said I would have said I would have waved him, sent him down, whatever has to happen. I would have probably waved him. But here's why I think people stay in the game with him.
Contract?
Well, the contract is obviously a huge part for the Tigers. But you know, that strikeout and inning thing is still something. That's it. Okay, that's it. That's my end of my speech. I'm not gonna sell you on anything because I think he's done. I thought he was done weeks ago. But that's the only thing I can think of. And obviously with the Tigers, it's a contract thing. Because if this guy was making a couple $1 million a year, he would have been waived a long time ago. Obviously they cut bait with Pelfrey and with Lowe. How many?
65.
That's insane.
Yeah.
That's an insane amount.
Yeah. 248-539-9797. Open lines. Ticket text 97136. Whole bunch of picks here. Let's get caught up for all those that send in your texts. The perfect pick for the Detroit Lions at 24. Dream pick for the Lions. 21st pick. The Detroit Lions select
20.
21st pick in the draft. Lions select JT Watt. He's a beast. He'll be a future TJ Watt.
Oh,
future Hall of Famer. That's Ray. He wrote JT. So another vote for Watt.
I'm warming up to him a lot more, too. Are you?
Not as much, but I wouldn't be mad. The guys I want, again, I listed the players I think that all be on the board. Davis, Jared Davis, linebacker from Florida, Grill Peppers, Takaris McKinley, Taco Charlton, Charles Harris. Watt would be after those guys. He'd be in the 6th hole. The pick is in. Running back Joe Mixon. He's the best running back in the draft. The Lions have given permission with the solid upgrade of the offensive line. This is the perfect pick. I don't know what Lions have given permission means.
Mark DeFore signed off and said, go ahead.
Okay, he states that as a fact. Do we believe that that's a fact?
He's just offering this up. This is like us. I don't think that's a fact.
Okay.
And that's his reasoning going into it. Is that they'll do it because this happened.
What the hell is going on? The pick is in. The Detroit Lions select Joe Mixon, running back out Oklahoma. That's from Jason. My dream pick, Joe Mixon. He'll complete our offense. Teams will struggle to match our scoring. Worth the risk, in my opinion. It's from Mike and Southgate. Well, they run on Joe Mixon. Lions pick TJ Watt for sure. If he has half the work ethic of his brother, he's going to be a monster. That's from Chad. Pick is in. If you can get a running back that carries the rock 20 times a game and gets you 100 yards a game, I'm taking Dalvin Cook. Sold me in the ball game.
If he's there. I don't think he'll be there, and I don't want to take a running back. Just to follow up on the Tigers, they did make a move.
Oh, that's right. Yeah, go ahead.
Jose Iglesias has been cleared from concussion protocol. He's been activated. He'll play this afternoon.
Mm-hmm.
And the corresponding move is to send Kyle Ryan back to Toledo, the relief pitcher, left-hander. Struggle.
Yeah, he's had a bad few outings here consecutively, and you know what's funny is I find myself kind of watching the bullpen implosions and thinking good, because most of these guys, and let me explain, most of these guys aren't going to pull out of it. I don't think it's the use of the bullpen, but the situations they've been putting in, I don't think they're up to the job. And if the Tigers can somehow hang around first place, it might force the new Illich regime to say, you know what, go spend some money. Go trade for somebody. Let's add a bullpen. It's not like they're plentiful prospects to trade for a bullpen arm, but I wouldn't freak out if they stay around first with bullpen implosions. Guess what? They might have to get better bullpen arms. One or two. All right, Musetti gets his iPhone 3. Paper Cat's flying to the draft in Philadelphia. He gets on his plane. This is 2 nights ago. The following happens, and he's trying to figure out what it was. Let's replay the scenario, and we want you to text us or tweet us. What do you think it was? Here's what happened.
Eight rows back, right? And he comes in the very last person on the plane. Sits in row 10. Yeah, C, row and a half in front of me. And that's where there's four first-class rows, and then goes to row 10. Then the guy sits on the plane, puts his bag down, and sits there for about 45 seconds, stands up, walks off the plane. Another guy walks on, not even a minute later, sits down in a seat. And I was just perplexed as to what was happening, because he was like the last person on the plane. Nobody came up and said anything to him. Couldn't figure out what was going on.
Okay. Guy sits down on a plane with a bag, 45 seconds, gets up, walks off the plane. Less than a minute later, another guy gets in, same seat. Now, Burkett goes into a degree of explanation, and we're going to hold that until 11:48. But we want your guesses. What do you think that was all about? And what would you be thinking at the time?
If a dude comes and sits down on the plane, looks like he's the last one to get on the plane,
mm-hmm.
and then 45 seconds later gets right back up and leaves,
mm-hmm.
my first thought is, oh, he just got on the wrong plane, but it's tough to get on the wrong plane when you have to hand your ticket to someone there.
Yep.
So that's not it.
Well, how about this, too? And I think he didn't say whether or not the guy took his bag, right?
I thought he said he took his bag.
Did he say if he took his bag? Because I don't think he does say he took his bag. And I'd be like, why did he leave his bag? It's in the bag. Somebody check the bag. Because that might be snakes.
Let's hope not. If he gets up and leaves, does he have to drop dirty?
But then somebody else came in and took his seat.
That's awful. Somebody else comes and takes his seat. He gets up and leaves, and somebody takes his seat. He's the Sky Marshal or whatever it is.
Air Marshal.
And then realizes, oh, wait a minute. He was like that, filling in. He's the last one on the plane. Okay, I guess I got a guy. And the guy's not here yet. Then the guy shows up, so he's out.
All right. Now, text us what you think it is, 97136. Tweet us, @MGator971. And we'll play Dave's. He kind of explains it, but it leaves you asking one more questions. We'll play what he had as his follow-up, because Dave started asking questions. Play his follow-up today at 11:48. 97.1 The Ticket.
Hey, I can't urge you enough to check out Superior Buick GMC in Dearborn. They now have 2,000 vehicles in stock, which is more than any other dealer in the entire country. And
what we're all trying to do is trying to make this a better world for the next generation coming up. Kind of like the L, the G, the B, over the last 25, 30 years, it's amazing how far that community has brought this issue forward. The trans community is not there. It's going to take a lot of work. So I think I am better off using what I want to do and what I do best, which is kind of more behind closed doors, quietly, within the Republican Party. To make change, to make friends, to have an impact that way. We need other trans people to maybe do something different. I'm all for it. I just want our community to be united as best we possibly can, so we can make a difference.
I have to admit, though, the behind closed doors thing still kind of confuses me. I mean,
tell me why.
Well, it seems like people have a very different reaction, not better or worse, but just different, to you than they have to someone like Laverne Cox from Orange is the New Black. There are very different reactions, and it occurs to me that you, granted, are the transgender person who has said that you are Republican and trying to reach out to the GOP, but you're also the person who they first knew as Bruce Jenner, the guy who won the Olympic
medal. Oh, that's true.
The guy from the Wheaties box. And it just makes me really question whether or not the Republicans who you've met with really want to meet with you, or they're meeting with the ghost of Bruce Jenner. Do you think they are actually interested in you?
Actually, that's a very interesting question. To be honest with you, yes. The door opener that I had, like, I literally had dinner with like 15, 17, after, but it was a large group of evangelical, Christian, conservative, Republican senators and congressmen. A private dinner, private home. And we sat down, because I'm also a person of faith, and we sat down there for 3 hours. And I brought another trans girl with me, who had just a wonderful story and articulate. She's just great. But yes, the reason I got in the door is because, yes, I was Bruce Jenner, and at one point, and they all knew Bruce, and they're all probably shocked at where I'm at today. But if that's what it takes to get into these lawmakers and have a conversation with them on a subject that they know nothing about, that's fine with me. I really don't care. And I'm not the ghost of Bruce Jenner. I am Caitlyn Jenner. I am a real person. I am hopefully very smart, intelligent, and I want to do the best I can for my community. So, yeah, if Bruce gets me in the door, great. I want to get in that door. That's what it takes.
So when you have these meetings with conservative Republican lawmakers, what's your goal? What do you want to come out of these meetings, these dinners, these encounters with you?
I want them to know that trans people and people within the LGBT community are not like these crazy, weird, crazy people. We're intelligent, we're smart, we're part of society, we own companies, we run companies. We're a vibrant part of this society. Yes, do we have our problems? Absolutely, and I want them to be aware of what those problems are. With homelessness, we have 19 states in the United States, in the U.S. and in Washington D.C. and I think 200 cities who actually have non-discrimination clauses in place. But we have 32 states in the United States where you can still legally discriminate against people in the LGBT community. You can deny them housing. You can deny them benefits. You can deny them doctors. They just don't have any rights in those 32 cities. You can, in those 32 cities, actually get for proper identification, which is very important for trans people. You can't even get your birth certificate changed to, let's say, male to female, from an N to an M. I was fortunate. I was actually born in the state of New York. And in that state, yes, you can get your birth certificate changed. So yes, I had every document all the way down to my birth certificate changed to gender marker F. But those types of things, there's no continuity across the United States when it comes to dealing with trans issues. I want to fight to change those things, yes.
In the book, you talk, obviously, about your family and your upbringing, and I did not realize that your father was an Army Ranger who was part of the D-Day landing at Normandy and survived Normandy. And you refer to him in terms of your views of not only sports and a lot of the life lessons you took, but also your view of what courage really is and how people might view what you have done and your outspokenness as courageous. And you say that you don't really consider it super courageous because, you know, D-Day, that's the standard you have. How do you view what you're doing personally? If not courageous, then what?
If not courageous, then what? I would say daring.
Daring.
Daring. I had, when I decided, and I finally in my heart and soul after 65 years, I decided to live my life authentically. Yes, it was. It didn't take courage because I had to. That's not courage to me. But was it daring? Oh boy, it was. I had no idea what the response was going to be. You know, one of the things that people have a hard time, because actually, you know, it's pretty interesting. It's almost 50-50 of transgender people is male to female and female to male. They're just relatively equal, except you never see the trans men because they're very, they blend into society so well. Testosterone is a very powerful drug. It's harder to go from male to female. And so I had no idea what the response was going to be. If I did this, I mean, at the time I was getting destroyed by the tabloids, just destroyed by them. I had two or three cars following me everywhere I went. I couldn't move without some paparazzi taking a picture and then, you know, some rag magazine all over the world writing some stupid article because I never talked to anyone.
But didn't you kind of bring that paparazzi on yourself, though? I mean, didn't you kind of invite some of the
attention? I never called one of them. No, you can't. You don't.
But you chose to be on E! You chose to be part of the series. I mean, is that just kind of part of the concept?
It's not like, no, not even. No, it's a television show. That's what I do for a living. I've been doing it for 40 years. It's like, no, I don't go there. It's not like I do a television show because I'm asking for paparazzis and all that BS. I did that show. Why? Because, hey, I enjoy fun. I enjoy working. But more importantly, I enjoy working with my children. I thought it was a great opportunity for my kids. And you know what? It was. You look at my children. They took that show and used that show and built up a great business for themselves. And I'm very proud of them for doing that, you know? And so, yeah, that would have been all about. It wasn't about me. You know, I stayed in the background as much as I could. Yeah, did I earn a nice paycheck doing it? Absolutely. And, I had to work and do something, you know, so it was a great job. But I didn't do that, so I would have paparazzis following me. I'm still a very private person. I literally had to put up walls around my house before I came out, so the paparazzis couldn't take pictures from other hills. I had them chasing me all over. I outraced them. I'd ride my motorcycle and put a helmet on so they didn't know who was driving. I mean, I did everything for years just to get away from these guys.
I'm Joshua Johnson. You're listening to 1A. There is one aspect of your celebrity that I think is, you know, as I'm beginning to read the memoir, it's becoming kind of clear to me that the celebrity, in a way, has been, as you've kind of put it, to been a tool to increase awareness of what trans people deal with, including a story that's in the book about a teenager named Kyler Prescott, who was a trans boy who committed suicide in May of 2015. Kyler was 14 years old when he killed himself. There's a poem by Kyler that you include in the book that I'd like to read very briefly. The poem says...
I wish you would.
Sure, the poem says, "My mirror does not define me. Not the stranger that looks back at me, not the smooth face that belongs to someone else, not the eyes that gleam with sadness when I look for him and can only see her. My body does not define me, not the slim shoulders that will not change, not the hips that give me away, not the chest that I can't stand to look at when I look for him and can only see her. My clothes do not define me. Not the shirt and jeans that would look so perfect on him, but I know would never fit me when I look for him and can only find her. And I've been looking for him for years, but I seem to grow farther away from him with each passing day." That's a poem by Kyler Prescott, who committed suicide at the age of 14.
Make me cry.
Why is that? What is that? What went through your head and
the
your
turmoil.
Heart?
Oh, well, first of all, I went down and met with mother, father, family members, how devastated they were. The mother did everything right, Had the name changed, had everything done. In fact, 2 weeks after Tyler had passed away, She got in the mail his birth certificate with gender marker M. I mean, you talk about a tough deal for a parent. I can't even imagine what the family had been through. But yes, first of all, it's a 14-year-old. And how smart and eloquent he was. To be able to write a poem like that. And to have that all, you know, gone away. It's just a shame. Would have been a great part of society. Would have, I think, would have had a great life. And it just never happened. And the whole family was devastated by it. So, yeah, that's the tough side of this issue. Kyler had the toughest combination of some bullying, mostly by adults, not by his classmates and this and that. Also online bullying, which is obviously very difficult, but also he did suffer from depression. And you have that combination together of depression, bullying, and not fitting in to the world. That's a tough one. And no matter what, seems like the parents will do in a situation like that. Sometimes they do lose their child. And that's tough to take. And I hope with my experience and being positive about this can change some of that. And I feel in some ways it has. I've gotten letters from young trans people who said, you know, I was thinking about, you know, killing myself. But when I saw what you did, I thought, you know what, if little Caitlin can do it, I can do it. So that makes me feel good. And hopefully we all in our community set a very good example that life will be okay.
So let's talk about where things go from here. In February, President Trump withdrew the previous administration guidelines for transgender students choosing their restrooms in school, and you tweeted a video at him.
Finally, I have a message for President Trump from, well, one Republican to another. This is a disaster, and you can still fix it. You made a promise to protect the LGBTQ community. Call me.
That's a clip from the Twitter video. Did the president ever call you?
No.
Oh, did you really think he was gonna? I mean, really? Did you really think you were gonna get a phone call?
Honestly, I was hoping, you know, hey, Donald, come on. I called him out. Let's go. Let's get it going.
But were you hoping again?
I didn't see him at the inauguration. He said he wanted to play golf with me, and I thought after he did the Title IX thing was just an absolute disaster for me, for Donald Trump.
I know, well, I wonder going forward, though. I mean, these are very tough times, it would seem, for the Trump administration and the GOP to try to get things done. The Affordable Care Act repeal didn't happen. Now there's this big tax plan. There's all these international issues. How confident are you going forward, seriously, that the GOP is going to deal with LGBT issues in the midst of all this other stuff, even with the Republicans?
Yeah, no, I'll tell you what, I'm with you. I got to keep my eye on these guys. Trump is the man. He's the president. Anything that goes on in that administration, it's bottom line, it's his fault, okay? He's the president. Now, you can go down the line and look and see the people that he has put into place. I guarantee you that Title IX, when he repealed Obama's Title IX kind of equality for all students in school, and especially the transgender kids, when he repealed that, the big problem in the room was Jeff Sessions.
The Attorney General.
Our Attorney General. He's been very anti-LGBT, okay? He was the, you know, he convinced everybody, but the bottom line is, Donald Trump, he signed it, okay?
And he hired Jeff Sessions.
I know people that were in the room and talked to people that were in the room. And so the bottom line is, it is Donald Trump and it's his administration.
That's Caitlin Jenner. Her new book is called The Secrets of My Life. She will be signing copies at the 6th and I Historic Synagogue in Washington tonight at 7. Caitlin Jenner, thank you so much for talking to us.
Thank you. It was my pleasure.
Remember, you can connect with us about upcoming episodes at the1a.org. That's the word the number one, the letter a.org. 1A comes to you from WAMU, part of American University in Washington, distributed by NPR. Until we meet again, I'm Joshua Johnson. Thank you so much for listening. This is 1A.
Michigan Radio, 1 Mike 3. Fresh Air is next. Then at 1, it's Here and Now, the daily digest of news and culture, with commentary from Michigan Radio's senior news analyst Jack Lessenberg. Support for NPR comes from NPR member stations and from Constant Contact with email.
You there. Michigan's economy is growing, and Troy Laser and Fab is growing to meet the demands of a variety of industries. To meet those demands, Troy Laser and Fab needs to add to their already great team. Troy Laser has positions for CAD operators, laser operators, press brake operators, and estimators. Troy Laser treats their team members with great pay and great benefits, including profit sharing and 401k plans. Experience is preferred, but on-the-job training is available. Email your resume to hire@troylaser.com. Equal opportunity employer.
Yeah, your toilet's definitely clogged, but I think I found the problem. Sir, is this your action figure?
Yes, I sent him in to check out the pipes.
As a small business owner, you've got enough to deal with. Let the experts at Progressive insure your business so you can focus on more important things. With over 30 commercial auto and business coverage options, we'll build a plan that's right for you.
I got something else. Are these toy cars?
Had to send in backup.
Visit ProgressiveCommercial.com to get started. Progressive Casualty Insurance Company and Affiliates.
Got a paint project you haven't started? Now's the time to begin.